This is the story of United Airlines Flight 811. On the 24th of February, 1989, a United Airlines 747 was to fly from Honolulu, Hawaii to Sydney, Australia with a stopover in Auckland. This plane had 355 people on board. This was actually a flight that had originated in LA, and so far everything was going great. This next leg of the flight would be flown by Captain David Cronin. This was his second to last flight before retirement. First Officer Gregory Slader and Flight Engineer Randal Thomas. On the ground, the incoming captain surveyed everything. The notices to airmen, the maintenance records of the plane, flight restrictions, etc. The plane left the gate at 1:33 a.m. local time. As they taxied, the pilots checked if everything was closed and secured. With everything in the green, they lined up on runway 8 right. The plane took off and it turned towards the dark skies over the Pacific. As they climbed, they picked up some thunderstorms on their radar, so they radioed for a deviation to the left and they turned the seatbelt sign on, just in case things got a bit too bumpy. As the plane climbed to its cruising altitude, the plane passed through 22,000 feet. The pilots heard a thump which shook the plane. This thump was immediately followed by a loud explosion. They had just had an explosive decompression. Cabins are pressurized so that people inside can breathe. An airplane is essentially a pressurized aluminum can. When there's a breach in the skin of an airplane, all of that pressurized air rushes out. Actually, for a decompression to be considered an explosive decompression, it must happen in less than half a second. This is so fast that the lungs can't decompress fast enough. On flight 811, something had breached the hull. The pilots donned their oxygen masks, but they found that there was no oxygen available. The captain immediately initiated an emergency descent to get the plane down to a safer altitude, and they also turned the plane away from the storm. As the captain worked on getting the plane down to a safe altitude, the first officer was on the radio with ATC, letting them know about their emergency descent. As they descended, they noticed that engine number 3 was in trouble. It was vibrating a lot, and exhaust temperatures were plummeting. The second officer went into the cabin to see what was happening. He came back with bad news. The entire right-hand section of the forward fuselage was missing. Cabin crew members were holding on for dear life as strong winds whipped through the cabin. As the pilots took in the news about their plane having a huge gaping hole in its side, engine number 4, the outboard engine on the right-hand side of the plane, started giving them trouble. People could see flashes of flames from the engine. Not wanting to make things worse, the crew shut the engine down. Soon, they were inbound to land on runway 8 left at Honolulu. They slowed the plane down and extended the flaps. This didn't go well. They had an asymmetric extension of the flaps, so they just used the trailing edge flaps on the right-hand wing. It was in this state that they made their approach, a plane with a massive gaping hole in its side, with 2 of its 4 engines out and flaps that did not work. But Flight 811 touched back down on the runway. At 2:34 a.m., the plane came to a stop on the runway, and they evacuated the plane right there on the runway. Unfortunately, 9 people were not accounted for on the ground. An extensive air and sea search for those 9 people failed to find them. On the ground, the full extent of the damage was visible. The forward cargo door on the right-hand side of the plane was gone. It had taken a substantial amount of the hull with it, which left a massive hole in the side of the plane. They analyzed the cracks and came to the conclusion that these cracks were overstress cracks and not fatigue cracks. This also explained the damage on the right-hand wing of the plane. The falling debris had hit the right-hand wing and damaged it. To get to the bottom of this mystery, they'd need the door that fell off of Flight 811. Fortunately, Navy radar systems had tracked the door for most of its fall, and this gave the investigators a probable splash zone to work with. An underwater search was started on the 22nd of July, 1990, and by the 1st of October, 1990, the door was recovered from the seabed. With the door in their possession, they could run tests on it to figure out how it failed. Their tests showed that the door was structurally sound. It did not fail due to corrosion or something like that. The door was found in two pieces. It did not break apart in flight. It broke apart when it hit the water. So, how do you keep a cargo door on the 747 closed? The cargo system used three actuators. The main actuator moved the door from the fully open position into a partially open position. Once this was complete, a pull and hook actuator, as the name suggests, pulled the door in, closing it completely. At the bottom of the door, there are eight latches, or latch cams. They are the C-shaped locks. When the door closes, the latch pin, this metal bar on the door, slides into the C-shaped lock. Once it's in there firmly, the third actuator rotates these C-shaped locks, and an L-shaped metal part, known as a lock sector, moves in and secures the door. Think of how a baby wraps their hand around your finger. That's kind of how the C-shaped lock works. Shout out to Casey from the Pod Crash podcast for that great analogy. After that, once the door is locked, the actuators are depowered. They're not going anywhere. You can do this electrically or manually. If the locks were engaged, there's no way that the door would open, but somehow it did. The door recovered from the seabed gave them their answer. All eight of the lower latch cams, that is the C-shaped locks, were in the unlocked position. Flight 811's cargo door had not been sealed properly. As the plane climbed, the cabin was pressurized. At this point, the only thing that was keeping the door shut was the pressure exerted by the pressurization and the pull-in hooks, but those would not last forever. Soon, the pressure inside grew and grew until the door catastrophically failed. The lock sectors, the L-shaped part of the locking mechanism, were in the correct position, but they had gouge marks in them at the bottom from where the C-shaped locks had rotated, thereby unlocking the door. Something had caused these locks to unlock. The question is, what? They theorized that if the door was misaligned with the fuselage, then the C latches wouldn't be able to close properly. The wear marks on the latches and the L-shaped sector showed that the door was slightly misaligned, and that put extra strain on the locks. There have been cases where the doors had difficulty closing when the plane was fully loaded. The weight inside warped the plane just a bit, making it hard for the door to close due to a misalignment caused by the warping. In this case, they could hear a thumping noise from inside as the C-latches attempted to engage. But this is unlikely because ground personnel would be able to tell if the locks did not engage. What if the door unlocked after it had been locked? Remember the L-shaped sector lock? That was there to prevent the movement of the C-shaped lock if somehow they were powered up due to a short circuit or something. But the problem was that they weren't strong enough to keep the C-shaped locks from moving. This was because the L-shaped sector locks were too weak. They were made out of aluminum. This was a known flaw. A Pan Am 747 had issues with its cargo door, and pilots had to turn back because their plane would not pressurize due to the open cargo door. The FAA had mandated that airlines replace the L-shaped sector latches with stronger ones. They gave airlines 18 to 24 months to fix the latches. Flight 811 had not undergone the fix and thus was equipped with the weaker sector latches. We're not done. There's more redundancy here. The locking system is designed to work on the ground. The circuits that lock and unlock the door are designed in such a way that electricity is sent through them only when the plane is on the ground. A big part of that circuit is called the S2 master latch lock switch. It basically cuts power to the actuators when the door handles outside the plane are stowed. They looked at if a failure of the S2 switch would open the door in flight. For the door to unlock in flight, a lot of things had to happen. The APU, or the auxiliary power unit, had to be on. An air-ground relay circuit would have to fail. The S2 switch had to fail, and the ground handling relay had to fail. But they checked the relays, and they were fine. Also, the pilots turned off the APU after the plane had taken off. So, the door did not unlock in flight. That left them with one possibility. The door unlocked when the plane was on the ground. The recovered door had faulty wires with some insulation missing. They weren't able to prove with absolute certainty that a short circuit had occurred here, but it was very much possible. There was something off with the wiring system, though. I couldn't find a reference to this in the final report, but apparently, to see if the C-shaped latches could move after the door was locked, Boeing asked airlines to run a small test. They were asked to close the cargo door, stow the handle, and to then press the switch to open the cargo door. In this situation, the C latches should not rotate because the S2 switch should cut power to the actuator, but the C latches turned. They bent the L-shaped sector locks out of the way. What Boeing got was confirmation of a problem with the door and a bunch of pissed off airlines because their cargo doors had been damaged. In another instance, in 1991, United mechanics were investigating a circuit breaker tripping on another 747, and the cargo door on that 747 opened spontaneously despite it being closed due to electrical issues. In the end, they concluded that a stray signal from a malfunctioning S2 switch, faulty wiring, or both ended up moving the actuators from the closed position to the open position when the plane was on the ground. The open door ultimately opened in midair to disastrous consequences. This was a disaster that spent some time in the making. On the ground, the baggage handler secured the cargo door correctly. Due to some faulty wiring and switches, power was applied to the C-shaped locks, causing them to rotate. There was an L-shaped sector lock to prevent the C-shaped locks from rotating and thereby unlocking the cargo door. But the L-shaped locks were made out of weak metal. The C-shaped locks pushed them out of the way, and the cargo door was unlocked. From then on, it was just a matter of time before pressure inside was strong enough to blow the door off the plane. This incident is special for one more reason. One of the people who died on Flight 811 was Lee Campbell. He was traveling to New Zealand to visit his parents, Kevin and Susan Campbell. When they heard about what had happened to their son, they instantly hopped on a plane to Hawaii, and then they started their own investigation into Flight 811. They drove across the entire country, talking to anyone that would listen. They even presented their theory about the cargo door latches being faulty to the NTSB. Keep in mind, this was before the cargo door was found. If you want an in-depth account of what they went through, I highly suggest listening to the Pod Crash Podcast episode on Flight 811. Thank you for watching this episode of Mini Air Crash Investigation. If you like the videos that I make, do consider liking and subscribing. It will really help the channel grow. I will catch you guys next time. Stay safe.